Good evening, everyone. We welcome you all to Ortho TV Monday Motivation Webinar. This is for the first time, we are having two Monday Motivations. So all of us get motivated and get back out of the lockdown and go back to work soon. So we have with us Dr. Tushar Agarwal, who will be introducing the speaker today. Over to Dr. Tushar.
Hi, everybody. Good evening to you all. And honestly, I really appreciate everybody who joins us. Some of you may be joining us for the first time. Now, as you know, that there's an overdose of academic webinars which is happening for COVID-19. And it's not really working, right? We require to feel charged up to use all that academic knowledge. So we have two choices. Either we survive or we thrive. So with the objective of thriving, I have invited my MBBS batchmate, Dr. Parag Sanghvi, who is a radiologist, or rather was a radiologist now, I should say, in Mumbai area and in the Borivali Dahisar area. And he has now become a life coach. So who better than him, a doctor who has had a significantly great practice and who has actually given it up and is now a life coach. So he will actually begin, Parag, you will actually begin by actually telling us what a life coach does, right? And then we'll have the rest of your talk. So over to you, Parag.
Hi, Tushar. Thank you very much, Dr. Neeraj Bijlani. Thank you very much. And all my doctor colleagues and few of the friends who are not doctors, but have come on this platform to have to listen to my talk and my journey from a radiologist to a life coach. Thanks, Tushar. And I and Tushar go a long way back in our GS days, MBBS days. And it was really nice of him to invite me to give a talk to all you, my colleagues. Yeah, what a life coach is? A life coach is one who helps you overcome your challenges in any area, in any field, and thus help you achieve your goal. I mean, that's my definition of a life coach. And I am a life coach. And today I'm going to share the first part of this talk. I'm going to share my journey from a radiologist to a life coach. And I have learned a lot. I have developed myself from this journey. And I'll be sharing my learning curves with you. And maybe we can pick up a few of those learning curves to deal with this present COVID situation. And I'm sure each one of you have got an inspiring, scintillating story with you. And each story would teach us a lot of things. Even if you could reflect on your own story going back, you would learn lots of things. So yes, I'll take you back to 1993. May 1993, 12 days after my MBBS exams. In retrospection, I did the most stupidest things I could have ever done. Both my eyes underwent under the surgical knife to get rid of the refraction. And those time there was no LASIK. We had something called as radial keratotomy, RK. And being a medical student, I didn't do any study about it. I didn't find out. The only reason was in my family, I had 7 to 8 people who had undergone the same refractive surgery with the same doctor, and the history going back to 7 to 8 years, and all the operations, all the refractive surgeries were successful. So I thought, why not? My numbers were slightly high. So I underwent both my eyes, the same surgery, radial keratotomy. And that's when my life turned topsy-turvy. Everything in my life changed. I don't blame the doctor, and that's why I'm not taking his name today. But there's something which is not in your control, and that's exactly what happened with me. Instead of my numbers getting reduced, my corneas were butchered beyond repair, deep incisions, multiple incisions extending into the optic zones, and I couldn't see properly. My entire internship went into running from one ophthalmologist to another, trying to find out some solution. But I was not successful. After about 8 to 10 months of trial and error, I could get some contact lenses, semi-soft contact lenses, rigid gas permeable lenses, and I could get back my vision. I could not get the specs because there was very high asymmetrical astigmatism. And with those problems, I somehow finished my internship. And then came a time where I had to choose, I had to do my post-graduation. And that was the first step of my life where I had to make some compromise. I always wanted to be in the surgical line, and I could have easily got into ortho or surgery. But with my present situation, you know, the residency in surgery, ortho is very tough and tedious, long working hours. I couldn't do that. So I took a relatively lighter line, radiology. So that was my first compromise with myself and with the situation I was in. I always had teething problems with my eyes. I had to take care, could not wear lenses for long hours. I had to take a break in between and then again wear the lenses. Somehow I completed my post-graduation from Nair Hospital, worked in some private places for a year, but I always knew I couldn't work in a big institute because in the initial days we are supposed to work 12 hours, 14 hours at a stretch, and I didn't want to take any sympathy from anybody or any obligation. So I knew I had to start my practice so that I could have my flexibility, and I did start. I bought a small portable machine. Those times we had portable machine, black and white. I bought it and I joined a place where I had lots of work, lots and lots of x-rays to report, lots of sonographies, procedures, and I was doing quite well for that age and for that time. But 1 year down the practice, that eye problem started haunting me back. First, my right eye vision started dropping. In a span of 2 months, my vision dropped from 6x6, 6x9 to less than 6x6. I'm sure all of you will understand how bad that is. Only light perception. So I had to wind up my practice and again start running from one doctor to another doctor. All of them, they told me your cornea has become beyond repair. All you need is a transplant. But nobody was ready for the transplant. They told me, wait, you have got one more eye, you can do with it. I contacted a few doctors, corneal transplant doctors, experts in UK, in US. And fortunately, I got hold of one of the best corneal transplant ophthalmologists at that time. And he was a visiting faculty in Germany, Munich. I went there. Germany was a corneal transplant, cornea surplus country, I would say. So I got my first transplant in 2000. And of course, post-transplant, about 9 to 10 months, the sutures are there. After the removal of sutures, I got a contact lens fitted on it. And then I could see with my right eye. For 2 years, I was out of my radiology practice. And then I thought, okay, now I'm good. My right eye vision has come, left eye is good. Let me again try radiology. And during those 2 years when I was not able to do radiology, I was helping my father and my brother in their business. So that's the second compromise I made. Coming back, transplant in right eye good, left eye was okay. I again started working as a radiologist, did part-time jobs. Unfortunately, my left eye vision started dropping and I had to undergo a transplant in my left eye in 2002. And another waiting period of 9 months. So 2002 end, I got transplants in both my eyes with contact lens fitting and I could see well. And then I thought, yes, I can start again with my practice. And that's how I started my own diagnostic center in 2003 in Mumbai, Dahisar. I shifted my residence and I started on a small scale. And over a period of 13 to 14 years, I was good in my practice. My practice grew in terms of patients, in terms of recognition, in terms of acknowledgement, in terms of money, in terms of space, in terms of equipments. It grew. And mind you, all this time, the problems of my eyes were always there. I could not work for longer hours. I had to take a break in between. But I was happy and I was doing quite well. That's my story as a radiologist. And then something happened in 2015. In December 2015, or probably starting from November 2015, I realized there's something wrong. My vision is going down. I'm getting exhausted. My eyes are getting exhausted. So I had a checkup and I realized my cornea was not doing so well. So many years down the transplant, the wear and tear had taken its toll because I was 40 plus, the accommodative changes were playing its role. Eyes were getting exhausted. And that's the time when I took a call to abort my baby of 14 years, my practice, my center. It was a tough decision. But I took the decision. I gave up my practice to a budding radiologist. The clinic is still there. My name is still there, but I gave up everything. So that was the third compromise of my life. And I thought I had seen the movie Zindagi Na Milegi Dobara. So I said, okay, fine. God has given me an opportunity to retire early. Let me enjoy life. And I tried doing many things which I always wanted to do. Lots of things. But after doing it for 1 year, I started getting bored. I was used to a very hectic schedule as a radiologist. And then I had nothing to do. All my colleagues, all my friends are all senior, famous, busy doctors like Tushar. So I couldn't call them up at 11 o'clock in the morning. Hey, Tushar, what are you doing? Let's go out. Nobody was there. I was feeling lonely. So I said, let me do something which will keep me involved. And that's when I came across this concept of life coaching. That's where I thought, let me do something which will keep me involved, and in the process, I will be able to touch somebody's life. So that's my journey, why being a radiologist, I am now practicing as a life coach. This is my second innings. And every innings begins with a zero. You know, no matter how successful you are in the first innings, you have to still start the second innings with a zero. That's what Sunil Gavaskar had told Harsha Bhogle. So I picked up this wonderful, profound statement from after listening Harsha Bogle that every innings, so you have to start all over again. No matter how successful I was, how well recognized I was, I had to start my second innings as a life coach all over again. I had to prove my credibility to everybody. It's been a wonderful journey. And in this journey, I have learned a lot. And I thought that I want to share with all of you what I have learned, what I have developed in this entire process of journey. And I'm sure there are many points, many learning curves in my journey, which from which we can learn, we can implement and come over this so-called COVID scare, the COVID situation. We've all become so much obsessed by COVID, COVID, Corona. Believe me, I have used this journey and I am not at all affected. I'm very happy. And I'll tell you why. So these are the learning curves. Which I learned from my practice, from my journey. The first lesson which I learned and which I am still implementing in my life is never give up. Perseverance. Persistence. It was this never give up attitude of mine, which I don't know how I developed. Maybe I wanted to prove to myself that in spite of all odds, I can be a good radiologist. Maybe I wanted to still to prove to myself that in spite of all odds, I can be a good life coach. Never give up. If you believe in your ability, if you believe in your capability, never give up. And this thing, we can apply it in our this COVID times. Most of us are already successful. Maybe few of our colleagues are very young, starting their journey, either with the hospital or in their private practice. But never give up. This is just a temporary phase, a very small phase. We just have to learn to live with it and deal with it. We are all good. Be there and we'll swim out to the other end of the sea. I would not say river, but the sea. The second learning curve for me, this, that your profession is not the end of the world. This was told to me by a very dear friend when after my, I had to give up my radiology practice and both my vision in my right eye was stopped, dropping down. At that time, a friend told me that, Parag, you know what? You may not practice as a radiologist, but you can do so many things. So yes, take this time as an opportunity. Not giving up your profession, absolutely not, because this is something we all are very passionate about. But in trying to find out what are the other things which you would like to do, what are the other things which you would like to follow, which would give you immense happiness apart from your profession and money, of course, yes. And try following it. Use this time. You will never get this time. A successful doctor never gets a time. He's always so very busy. He doesn't get time to do anything. So use this time and try to find out things beyond your profession. So that was my learning curve. The third thing which I learned is you have to realize and accept your situation, the ground realities. Just post MBBS, I realized that even though I was too much attracted to surgical line, I couldn't because of my eye problem. And so I took up radiology. After that, I knew I couldn't work continuously for 12, 14 hours. So I started my practice. And I accepted, okay, I have to take break in the afternoon. I cannot do too many night calls. Fine. So you have to know yourself. And similarly, each one of you practicing doctors have to understand the ground reality. Corona or COVID is here to stay with us. And it's going to stay with us for quite some time. So we don't need to be courageous or do something stupid, but we have to accept it. And we have to mold ourselves, our practice, our thought processes, our way of, I would say, dealing with it after understanding these ground realities. Adaptability. You need to adapt to the present situation. You cannot compare your present situation to your past, that you had so many patients to see, you were so busy working, you're making so much money. You have to adapt to the present situation because that's what's going to help you. Not digging the past, not living on the past, but to understand the present situation, to get adapted to it, and then to find a way forward. We need to look forward. The reason. I don't know whether this learning curve will actually help us in this COVID time, but the fact that I put it here is that we all should have a reason to do something. I, in spite of my eye problem, continued or pursued radiology. I had an option to join my father's business, but I didn't because this was something I was passionate about. I had a reason, and the same reason I have got when I'm practicing as a life coach. Two reasons. One is it would keep me involved after.
Sir, are you there?
Hello. One is that it would keep me involved after leading such a hectic life. And second is that I would be able to touch someone's life. That were my reasons. You have to find out your reasons why you are doing it, apart from the profound satisfaction, contentment, and the money. So even when you want to follow something beyond your profession, first find a reason. You should know why you want to do. Because without having any reason, it's pointless pursuing something. And each one has got their own reasons. The sixth learning curve is you.
Dr. Parag, we cannot see your screen. You're showing a PowerPoint?
Yeah, I am showing a
PowerPoint. No, it is not being seen only.
Okay, so
just share your screen again.
I'll do that. Give me a moment. All this while I was sharing the...
No, screen was not never seen.
Okay.
But I think his talk was more emphatic because of that.
Yeah.
That is why I did not realize only that there is a PowerPoint.
Okay. So I think I will continue rather than spending time finding out how to get it back. Is it okay?
Yeah, fine.
Okay. So the sixth was intent of achieving something, you know. When you want to achieve something, and especially right now that we are in that, you know, a semi-paralytic state, that nothing is moving, no patients coming, nursing homes, most of them are closed, hospitals not working. Keep one intent, the desire that, yes, I will overcome it. I had that intent of pursuing radiology. I have the intent of pursuing life coach as my second innings. So each one of you, without intent, there was that movie Chak De, right? And Chakde Shah Rukh Khan, initially when all the girls were against him and he was told not to leave the coaching, he said, Krishna ji, niyat nahi hai. And after that McDonald scene, he says, ab niyat dikhti hai. So that's exactly that niyat has to be there. The intent to do something has to be there. And that intent will take you to places. That intent took me to places and it will take each one of you to places. The second curve, the seventh curve is, we all know nothing is life is, you know, permanent, constant. Only thing which is constant is change. So this name, fame, money, which we have earned through our profession, it gives us a good high. But, and it makes us addicted to all these things. We are so much used to everybody looking up to us, taking advice from us. One day, everything in some way or the other, when it goes down, I'm not saying it going all the way, we feel that, oh shit, what have we lost? And we can't live without it. And we need to learn to live without it. So that's, for me, I lost everything in one go. My identity as a radiologist, my money, my fame, my recognition. And it was a very difficult phase of my life. And it took me quite some time to overcome that phase. So we have to understand that nothing is permanent. Let's accept it. And in a similar way, this COVID is not going to be permanent. Of course, it will stay there, but its severity is going to go down. We'll be developing immunity. We will be learning to not only deal, I repeat this statement again and again, deal, learn to deal with it, learn to live with it, all of us. And we'll sail through. The eighth learning curve was happiness has its own definition. It's like fingerprints. My definition of happiness is different. Dr. Tushar's definition of happiness is different. And Dr. Neeraj, his definition of happiness is. And each one has to define his own definition of happiness and follow. What are the things that make him happy? Try to do it. Try to achieve it. I'm slightly digressing from the topic, but I thought I should share with you is this concept of ikigai. Ikigai is a Japanese concept. They say that people, Japanese people are more happier than us because they follow this concept. And there are four components. Do something which you are good at. Do something which you are passionate about. Do something where you can earn from it and do something where you can contribute to the world, where people want your services. Fortunately, as doctors, we are actually doing it. We are successful, we are good at it, we are earning money, we are contributing to the society, everything. But still, some of us are not happy. And the reason is because we are not satisfied. The intellectual people in their pursuits of achieving more and more, we tend to be unsatisfied. So remove that unsatisfaction because you already are in a zone of happiness. And the ninth learning, I quote Steve Jobs, they spend each day as that's the last day of your life. Not literally, but in a way that enjoy your life, do something what you want today. Don't procrastinate. Don't keep it for later in the future. Once I retire, I'll do this, I'll do that. Start doing it. And you'll see the fun. And this Steve Jobs had told in his commencement speech in 2005 Stanford, where he was telling about his story, and he said he was diagnosed with a pancreatic tumor and he was told he didn't have much time. And then some biopsy, they took a biopsy and it was not so malignant and he could stay for more than 10 years. And during that phase of 10 years, Steve Jobs became the Steve Jobs which we know. And in his commencement speech, he gave us this golden statement that spend each day as if that's the last day of your life. And I was so much moved by this statement that I tell everybody whom I meet that enjoy the present. Of course, we can plan our future, but enjoy the present and don't neglect the present for the future. And the last learning curve is you just cannot plan everything. Some things happen. We have to take each day at a time. No matter how efficient we are in planning, but there are certain things. From nowhere, this COVID thing happened. And all our plans, plannings, everything went haywire. So no matter how hard you try, how good you are at planning, some things are beyond our control. So yes, these are my 10 learning curves. I learned from it. I'm sure you will learn from it. And Tushar, we have some time, so I would like to talk about our present concerns.
Yeah. Parag, yeah. There is this question.
Yes.
Okay. So how can we keep our passion alive, especially if the profession and passion may not be exactly the same, you know, and then we find it difficult to balance.
Absolutely.
Like, for example, if somebody is a surgeon and he also likes art or he likes singing, right? So how can he keep both of them alive and strike the right balance?
Yeah, most of us, we are in that dilemma.
Or like, for example, like I discussed with you, you know, I run a hospital and yes. I like academics. So how to strike the right balance between practice and academics? It becomes very difficult.
So here comes setting your priorities. Here comes that you need to set your priorities. So that are priorities. So I'm not telling you neglect your priorities, but set your priorities. So if the gentleman surgeon, if naturally he has to follow his surgical line and he has to earn money because that's the earning part, there are two ways I would like to deal with it. One is develop passion. Because it's a line where you are not only earning money, you are helping others also in the process. So develop passion towards his present profession right now. And I'm sure he's very passionate about it.
He is.
And he, of course, all of us, we are. But the second thing is if he's passionate about singing, he has to take out time, and that's time management. You cannot. So I would say, for example, as an orthopedician, you are seeing 100 cases a day. You're operating.
Let's not get into that. Yeah, but
no, so it's a hypothetical. So let me say that Dr. Tushar is saying 100 cases a day and he is operating 3-4 cases a day, right? And he does not get any time to follow his passion. I would say that can you cut down to 80 patients? Can you, if possible, I would not talk about the surgical part because if it's urgent, then yes. You need to do it, but at least seeing the patient, that would spare you about an hour, a 1.5 hour. Can we then devote that time? It's time delegation. It's time delegation. So it's about time management.
Okay. Another thing which I feel is that, you know, what may happen is that there is a different level of success you will have to set for yourself. The benchmark would be different because the amount of time you're devoting to each would be different.
Absolutely.
So if this same gentleman feels that he's going to reach to an X point in singing, then he will obviously have to give an incremental time to that. Am I correct? Because if you compare, let's say if you're doing a practice riyaz of 2 hours of singing per day, and then, you know, what I mean is that, not digressing too much from our core topic, but besides time management, you also have to set a valid benchmark for yourself.
So here, Tushar, what the gentleman was talking was about his passion and not about success. We are trying to converts both the things into one thing.
Okay, fantastic.
So passion, I am passionate about playing cajon. I am actually play cajon, right? So it's a percussion instrument. But I know that I am playing it for myself. It gives me a kick. It gives me a high. I am not going to play for being professional or something.
Perfect.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So any more questions, Tushar, or I can continue for some time?
No. You continue the talk. I was just making the, sort of the monologue. Absolutely. We'll have more questions and I'll let you know then.
Of course, you want to take one or two more questions? We can take it right now.
No, you continue. I'm just scanning through the questions.
Okay. So now coming is the present COVID situation. So I have told much about my life. Let's talk about each one of yours life. And that's first, we need to identify our concerns. What's bothering you? Is it your practice? Or are those the financial worries right now? Or is it the COVID fear? Or is it boredom? You know what, doctors are used to working long hours and now sitting at home doing nothing, the boredom strikes you. Ab kya karne ka? Practice. Is it something related to your practice? Your practice is not as it was before. It stopped. You cannot practice like you were practicing before. What next? How many more months? Surgical cases aate hi nahi hai, patients are not. What about my nursing home? Financial worries. Many of you must have taken home loans or loans towards your nursing home or for your equipments. Some of you might be doing a job, consultant's job in a hospital. The fear of salary cut or no increments or laying off. You need to identify your concerns, because after identifying your concerns, you will have to deal with them. Or is the COVID fear for you, your family, for your staff, the impending liabilities? How you're going to deal with patients coming to your clinic, your nursing home, your hospital?
So Parag, at the present moment, I think each and every one of the points which you have mentioned is probably affecting each and every one who is listening. I'm sure.
Absolutely. And that's why
it's pretty overwhelming. It's not one or two things which are disturbing, but
yes. So we are going in a proper medical way. We are going to try, I've tried to deal with it. Of course, not in great detail, in this medical way only. How are we going? So we are going to address our concerns like we address all our patients. There are two types of treatments, Tushar. One is symptomatic treatment.
Yes.
And one is disease specific treatment, right?
Perfect. Yes.
So similarly, we are going to address our concerns in a generalized approach and a problem-specific approach. So what are the generalized symptomatic treatment? First, I have already covered in our learning curves, is we need to realize and we need to accept the ground realities. We need to realize that, you know what, this is going to be there few more weeks and then I'll have to start my nursing home or start going to my work, to the hospital. People are already going there. Some of the nursing homes are shut off. They've started. And it's going to take quite some time. It's going to take quite some time in getting back to those pre-corona days. So the first thing is acceptance and realization. Afterwards, the most important thing, according to me, is resetting the mind. You have to reset your mind. We can't compare to the pre-corona days. Things have happened, things will change. And here, I would like all of you to go back to your journey. You know, after you finished your post-graduation, all of us were struggling. We all wanted to do some fellowships, take more experience, work with big doctors, and then jump into the private practice or join some institution. And we were not making money, but we very well knew that we would make money. Investing another 3-4 years. And all of us have gone through that. I want all of you to go back to those days. I'm sure each one of you are in a much better situation financially right now. So resetting the mind and knowing very well that this is just a temporary phase and we will all overcome it. So that is another generalized approach, resetting of the mind, accepting. Another thing which I thought was
Parag, can I just interrupt?
Absolutely.
Yeah, so this accept and reset.
Yes.
Some people may find it very tough. They know that they got to do it, but it may just not happen. So do you have any sort of tips as to how you can accelerate this process of accept and reset?
There are no such roles structure to accept or relate. So here what I am trying, the fourth tip which I was going to talk, approach, may in some way answer your question.
Okay.
Is sharing your concerns with your colleagues. And you will realize we all are in the same boat. It's not that you alone are doing it. You are alone are going through this phase. All of your medical colleagues are going through the same phase. And that will in a some way help you to reset your mind. And I think all of us are intellectual enough to understand the ground realities and to accept. The most difficult thing I know is when we go in comparison with our pre-corona days. And that's the difficult part. I totally understand. And you'll have to keep yourself involved doing certain things like what you are doing, Tushar. You are just upgrading your learning curves, trying to learn as much as possible, trying to socialize with people, with colleagues and non-medical colleagues also. This will keep you involved and occupied. And this is resetting mindset is one. There is no key, one key to all. So yes, sharing your concerns with your colleagues would help you in a long way, Tushar.
Okay.
No comparison. Again, this would also help resetting your mind. And acceptance is no comparisons with other industries. Don't start comparing yourself with people who are earning more in this. You know, Mark Zuckerberg, I read today that he was one of the people who really made money in this corona lockdown. He added up by 30 billions. I mean, he's one of those, maybe 1 or 2% people who are actually making money in this time. So let's not compare ourselves with other industries. Let's compare ourselves, if at all you want to compare, with your colleagues. So one more thing again, Tushar, is finding positives in the negatives. This is how we do some mental work. So each one of you try to find out in these last two months, what are the good things that have happened with you? Most of us will say, kuch hua hi nahi hai. I say, sab kuch negative hai, but try to jot down good things. I can share my good things that I am getting fantastic time with my family. I'm able to do things which I had never done before because of this lockdown. And each one of you can follow those passions. The gentleman who wanted to sing. Wow, this is the best time. He could do his riyas because he has got all the time in the world. So find the positives in the negatives. The family time, the me time, everything. One thing which I don't know how many of you will agree, but I have benefited tremendously from this thing is affirmations, positive affirmations. Those are just positive uplifting statements. Many psychologists and counselors tell us to do these things when we are going through a low. The positive things, you can say a few positive statements in the morning and before going to sleep. And it actually helps if you do it every day. Just do it. Don't apply your brains here. Just use positive affirmation statements. And maybe you will benefit from it. Utilize this time and all the surgeons to catch up all the sleep you have sacrificed in all these years. Sleep, exercise. You had a meditation session in the evening. Learn if you don't know how to meditate. That's the best. This is a generalized approach, just a symptomatic approach. And now coming back to our specific problems related approach. And I can see two things. One is practice related and one is financial. So few tips for the practice related issues here is get used to online consultation. Till the time you start working full time in your clinic, please take patients, do consultation, online consultation, reach out to your patient database, to the family practitioners, the physicians, tell them that you are available for your online consultation. Of course, you will not get as much work, but it will keep you occupied. I know in ortho, it's difficult, but at least start the cold cases. Second, the space constraints in your clinic where you can't take more patients at the same time. If you start your clinic for a few hours in a day, start working on appointment basis so that you can have 2-3 patients only at a time. If the space is more, you can accommodate more patients, but not walking patients. Following protocols of corona precautions with no leniency. I think till December 2020, we need to follow these protocols and precautions with no leniency. And one more thing, which is not directly involved to your practice, but a very important thing is maintain relations with your staff. It's time that you take care of your staff because they have stood by you and they will stand by you in terms of salary, in terms of expressing your gratitude. And the other, and one more point is collaborate with your colleagues. Many a times we don't want to collaborate with our colleagues. Get together, see if you can work out working together, because this is the time of collaboration rather than competition. The other problem which I foresee is the economical problem, the financial issues. Everyone in each industry is facing, and we doctors are no different. Check your reserves. I mean, you don't require me to tell you this, but of course, to complete the picture, I'm just telling, cut your liabilities. If you have any loans and you have any reserves with you, first pay off the loans. Liquidating your savings. Stay order, which we get in court. So get stay order on your future plans for some time. Do not invest in something great, in something big projects. Maintain liquidity with yourself. And you should have, of course, the contingency plans for your personal life, for your nursing home, whatever. So I think, Tushar, I am done with my talk.
So Parag, yeah. One thing is that specifically, you know, in about 4 or 5 sentences, if you can tell, how as a life coach, you can enable people to do this very briefly.
See, as a life coach, what does a life coach do? I said in the first few words of my talk is a life coach is one who help you overcome the challenges. The challenges are yours. You need to tell your challenges, and the life coach will act as a mirror. He will act as a catalyst. He will act as your support system. He will handhold you during this entire process. Try to tap your potential. Try to find out the resources which you already have, but you are unaware.
And it does work.
It is wonderful. It has to be experienced to believe it. It's wonderful.
Because
it works on only two principles. One is you yourself are capable of generating all the solutions. The solutions are within you. Many a times we do get the solutions on our own. Sometimes we are unable to achieve those solutions and we need some third person, a person who is non-judgmental about you, and he will help you achieve your goals.
Neeraj, you wish to ask something?
Yes. So, as a life coach, basically, supposing how do you go about it? Supposing if I want to take your services as a life coach,
yes,
or my association wants to take a life services as a life coach. So, yes. How do you go about it? What do you suggest? Do you do group gatherings? Do you do individual gatherings? How do you do?
So, when it is when the goals are very common goals, for example, in health and wellness coaching, quite a few goals are very common. So, in those cases, group coaching works. But if you, Dr. Neeraj Bijlani, has some personal issues, personal challenges with Tushar, Dr. Tushar may not be sharing. In that case, is one-on-one coaching, and one-on-one coaching is definitely always preferred over group coaching. Group coaching especially works in the leadership programs for the employees of corporates. But if you want to enhance yourself, if you want to go to another level, one-on-one coaching and one-on-one coaching, it's not so difficult. It's everything is online, on the video, on the phone. You don't have to meet. You have to sit at your home or your office. And the sessions go, typically one session is about 45 to 1 hour. And we discuss it on the phone.
So in the corporate world, Neeraj, it's like a common phenomenon, like everybody takes on a coach. But I think in our line, we doctors feel that we are like ourselves, we can coach ourselves. Like, you know, we feel we are the best administrators of our own hospitals also all the time.
So here I would like to share something which I was very, you know, impressed. There is one Dr. Atul Gawande. Quite a few must have heard about him. He's an American.
He has written four books. I have read all of them.
Yeah. And he has one talk. Everyone needs a coach. I suggest each one of us doctors, very well written, because he himself is a doctor, and the way he has given his own experience example, I think each one of us should see his YouTube video of Everyone Needs a Coach, how he has described that in spite of being so intelligent, so efficient, we can't see our blind spots, you know, the blind spots here. We need someone to see the blind spots which are here. So he's a fantastic talker, and I think each one of us should see that. That we need a coach, not because I am a coach and I'm selling myself, but frankly, even I need a coach. So I can't coach myself. I need to go out for someone, and who will coach me? So I have my mentor too.
Yeah, so
if we are, let me ask one query. So if we are running our own institutions, it's not a corporate. Our employees are much different from the corporates. 50% are not educated.
Absolutely.
Or they are 10th or 12th educated.
Yes.
So if we coach ourselves, what our purpose will be to coach ourselves so that we can handle them better?
Or
maybe furtherly, maybe coach them a little bit in their own style.
So absolutely. So your challenges are with your staff, Neeraj?
Yes, maybe.
Right. I'm just a hypothetical situation.
Yeah, there are some challenges. They are not so difficult, but they are there.
So if the challenges are just life coaching, you know, it is about you and your challenges. You present your challenges, and it may be related to your staff. It may be related to your financial problem or your time management and setting your priorities, following your recreational goals or your relationship problems. Or you're even, we are doctors, so we generally tend to neglect the health and wellness. But believe me, I have a friend who just told me, I don't know whether he's listening here, so I won't take his name, but he's told me, you know what, Parag, mere ko sirf aadhe ghante ka neend chahiye. And I was laughing. Yeah. He was so busy, starting from 9 o'clock in the morning to 12 o'clock at night continuously. The time he came.
Abhi sota hoga.
Now he's attached to a BMC hospital. So he's still working, but he has stopped his private practice. But I mean, I was amazed.
There is a question. Yes. So that's from a postgraduate student.
Yes.
Which is very nice. We rarely get it from them. So what he's saying is that as a PG student, what advice do you have to give him regarding his study preparations, orientation to surgery, and how he could excel in life, you know? I don't know how to whether I've been able to communicate, but
no. I think
that how to grow from a student level to a good consultant, and as a life coach, suppose if he comes to you,
yes,
asking this, you know, how would you guide him?
one thing which I don't know whether any of us, but I didn't follow in my first innings, is I never set my goals. And one thing I learned as a life coach is set your goals. So each one of us first should learn how to set our goals, whether it's PG education or whether he wants to pursue any super specialization and what actually he wants to know or do. So goal setting is a very important stage in anybody's life, whether he's a student or at our age. Our aspirations may be different, but goal setting is very important. Of course, there are so many key points, so many key characters, which we all know.
But I think you have hit the nail on the head by saying that, because if I go to recollect my past, people who had their goals clear achieved it. You know, somehow they achieved. And sometimes the goals are very apparent to you. Sometimes it takes a while before they crystallize in front of you.
Yeah. Yes, any more questions?
So, Neeraj, if there are no more questions.
I think we are done from our side.
Okay, so, just can I just summarize what he...
Yes, please.
So, I love these few statements which Parag said is accept and reset. I think that's a great thing to go together. Reason and intent. So, we have to accept and reset in our current situation. We require a reason and intent to move forward. And from taking cue from his statement, I would say a statement which Winston Churchill said in World War II. He said, never, never, never. And the fourth time, never give up. Yeah. So that's a very powerful statement by Winston Churchill. With Bijlani's permission, I would just like the audience, if they are interested, to go through four books. Okay, one is a book called Flourish by Martin Seligman. Second is a book by Resilience by Eric Griten. Third is a book called Grit by Angela Duckworth. And above all, we need to go through a book called Anti-Fragile by Nassim Taleb. We will be forwarding the names of these books along with Dr. Parag Sanghvi's summary of today's talk by tomorrow. Right, Neeraj? Neeraj?
Yeah, so Tushar, I would like to take this opportunity to thank all of you who are present here today for my talk. And thanks Tushar and Dr. Neeraj for giving me this opportunity.
And you have actually lived your struggle, right, Parag? So that's why you are a bigger source of inspiration. And it's a very nice moment for me. We are batchmates to share this platform. Courtesy Neeraj and Ortho TV.
Thank you very much.
Right then, Neeraj. Thanks a lot. Yeah.
Bye.
Bye-bye.